another episode of Coffee with Crosby and Musicians. Again, my name is Joe Stivers. I'm the band director at Crosby Middle School here in Louisville, Kentucky. And this is a series that we're doing in light of COVID. Our students here in Jefferson County Public Schools are having to learn online. And as their teacher, who's trying to make connections to them that are meaningful, we are taking this time to interview musicians and artists, which have started here locally, and we're starting to branch out from that to even more. So if you are interested in not only subscribing to our channel, but you yourself are an artist and musician who we could possibly interview, we would love to have you. You can find more information in our contact page at crosbyband.com, which is also in the comments of this video. In our third episode, we are interviewing someone special to us. He was a student teacher at Crosby years ago, has continued through graduate school, and is now a TA for saxophone. His name is Ben Morris, and you're in for a treat as he just talks about what music has meant to him through the years. And students, his performance is phenomenal. So let's welcome Ben Morris. Well, welcome back to another episode of Coffee with Crosby and Musicians. I have a special guest with us today, and Crosby has a connection to him as well, but we have with us today Mr. Ben Morris, and he was a student teacher at Crosby years ago, did a phenomenal job. But Ben, I'll let you just kind of start by telling us a little bit about yourself.
Hi, everyone. My name's Ben Morris. I student taught at Crosby Middle, and I think it was spring 2017, so a couple years removed anyway. But I've since then gone on to do a master's at Carnegie Mellon, and I'm currently in Miami, Florida at the University of Miami doing a DMA or a doctorate in saxophone performance.
So students, as you're listening to that, like, just so you know how prestigious that university is, like, it took a lot of work, and clearly Mr. Morris is talented, but to go to Carnegie Mellon is like a seal of approval, in my opinion, as you want to continue your saxophone endeavors. So kudos to you, Mr. Morris.
Thank you so much.
Absolutely.
It was fun.
And just so the students know what a TA is, will you elaborate on that?
Yeah, so I am a TA for the saxophone student or a studio at the Frost School of Music. And that means I'm a teaching assistant. So some of my duties will include teaching lessons to non-majors. I run the saxophone ensemble here at Frost, or co-run, I should say. There's another TA other than me. And we pretty much split all the logistical and teaching activities among the two of us and Professor Dale Underwood, who is our supervisor.
Awesome. Yeah. So there you go, students. All right, well, we've got five questions that the students helped me come up with that we've been asking every person. And the first is just, you know, thinking about our audience, which is middle school, and maybe your journey began after that. But when did music start kind of becoming a reality in your life? And if you can just tell us about that.
Yeah, wow. I actually was just going over this story the other day. I'm teaching a fair amount of lessons right now in our virtual reality that's going on. And someone asked me the same question. As far back as I can remember, my older brother was in band in high school, and as much as like younger brothers don't want to be their older brother, they want to like be their own person. I thought it was so cool, and I wanted to be in band immediately. So I spent the entire time wanting to play the saxophone. I knew I wanted to play the saxophone because I had heard like a jazz recording or something. I knew I wanted to do that. So when I was finally old enough and it was sixth grade, super, super excited to start playing the saxophone. And honestly, it kind of snowballed from there. I think the first realization I can remember about like when I really understood what it took to do this thing was, I think I was seventh or eighth grade, very early on, and I started practicing. I don't remember why I started, but like even like 30 minutes a day or something, right? Uh-huh. But before, I was a bad student and I didn't practice. It just was that way. I was a bad student. So I don't know. I had this realization. I started practicing and suddenly I could do the things that I couldn't do before. And, you know, obviously, Mr. Stivers, you have told your students, if you want to be able to do this, you have to work on it. It's obvious now, right? But at the time, as many times as my middle school director had said it, it didn't sink in for some reason. And so I started practicing and I started getting better and I could play all the notes that I was supposed to play and my playing tests went really well and all this stuff. And I remember then I was like, ooh, I like this. Mm. I remember feeling like, ooh, I like being good at this. And so I, through high school, I kept the same mentality. I would work on the things that I needed to work on till I could play them really well. And honestly, that's still kind of the mentality I have. I find things I want to play, and when I can't play them, I just, you know, now I'm a little more methodical, let's say, but I work on them. And yeah, so I started out just like anybody else, honestly. No prodigy here, just a very humble beginning that, you know, was based on a work ethic and just kind of continued from there.
And that I think also is not just like a nature that you have, but you probably learned being in band was also learning some of those skills to begin with. Like you're learning from scratch, something that you're interested in, but you knew it to see the fruit from your labor, it was going to take some practice. So students take note. So
Absolutely.
Yeah. I heard you say that jazz was something that maybe turned you on to saxophone. And that leads to our next question, just about what artists have inspired you in your musical journey, and would you care to share a couple artists and why they're your favorites?
Yeah, absolutely. I guess first and foremost, all my previous teachers have been artists that have had the most profound impact on me. Other than maybe, like I said in the beginning, I think it was a Cannonball Adderley record that I listened to that really got me wanting to play saxophone, and specifically the alto. These days, I'm more of a classical person, although I am getting like a minor in jazz studies right now. So I'm trying to do both, but most of my time is classical stuff. So, but musicians that inspire me, I mean, there's so many. I would say my first professor, Matthew Taylor, he did so much for me, both like technically and mindset wise. He was really integral in like getting me to think about practicing and progressing in a healthy way and not a destructive way, which is really easy for us to do when we can't do something to get upset about it. But he was really good about teaching you how to redirect that energy to something productive, because anger is very rarely productive in a musical setting or really any setting. Mm-hmm. And then my second professor at Carnegie Mellon, Dr. Jason Cush, was absolutely groundbreaking for me, teaching me a lot of independence, teaching me a lot of how to more or less set your own hours, how to be in charge of yourself. And his reasoning was, when you get out there on your own, you're going to be the one who decides whether something succeeds or fails. And that was a big epiphany for me. And then one throughout all of that is my current teacher, who is Dale Underwood, just an absolute legend in the saxophone community. He was the professor, the teacher of both of my previous instructors. And, you know, so I've had this a long time coming to be here. And he has just done so much. And I wouldn't even say it's like just teaching you how to be good at the saxophone. His ideas about music are just profound. And they come in the way of one sentence at a time. One sentence, he'll say something and you'll just be like, what? Oh, I have to reevaluate this entire thing I'm doing. But yeah, that's probably musicians that inspire me once I've actually met. Other than that, oh my gosh, so many jazz musicians. I love Joshua Redman. I obviously love Cannonball Adderley. Classical musicians, I have listened to an incredible amount of Timothy McAllister, Kenneth Che. Arno Bornkamp, it might be my favorite. Yeah, these are names that if you don't know and you play the saxophone, or if you play anything, honestly, you look them up and just listen to like the overt artistry that is exhibited. It's truly, truly amazing.
Absolutely. And a lot of the teachers and artists you mentioned, all backgrounds of life, but it seems to be this building of a mosaic for who you're becoming, you know? And man, Cannonball Adderley, you can't go wrong there. And students, the other artists he mentioned too, like wide variety of saxophone styles between classical, jazz, even some very modern stuff. So absolutely, Mr. Morris. The third question we have, you've kind of elaborated a bit about what you're doing now, but the students were saying, what's your current job and are you still performing? So obviously you're still performing and we know you're a TA, but would you care to tell us maybe a vision for where you want to go with music in your life?
Yeah, absolutely. So I got an email about this from a high school student not too long ago, asking some really difficult questions. It made me have to think about it myself for the first time in a while. But you'll hear that a music career is not necessarily a profitable one. And while I think that that could be true, I am convinced that there is space in the music world for anyone who wants to be there and is willing to put in the effort to be there. Now, it might not look like not everybody's going to be, saxophone virtuoso playing concerts, sure, but there is a niche somewhere. There is somewhere that you can fit in. And for me, currently, I can't say that I have any concrete plans. I'm here at the University of Miami for this year and next year to finish a 3-year degree. Hopefully I finish it in time and or on time. And after that, I'm open to, whatever comes my way. And that is a lesson I had to learn the hard way, is to not pigeonhole yourself, so to speak, into one thing. Have something you want. At the end of the day, when I am older and let's say I have a family or something, I want to be a college professor. I'm not sure that that is what I want to do in 2 years. I'm not sure how long it's going to be before I want that specifically, but I am not going to say no to it if it pops up. And I think that's an important mentality to have. I don't know that there is, it is what you make it, let's say. And so I'm teaching a studio right now. I'm an adjunct at a high school here in Miami, and so I teach a lot of the students there, and I go and do sectionals and things. But man, a career in music can look like so many different things. It is so versatile. And that's not even to mention the skills that you acquire or build while pursuing it. I mean, that and those apply to so many other things too. So yeah, that's a hard question to answer, but the long and the short of it is I'm just waiting to see. I'm putting my feelers out there. I'm doing the legwork, but at the end of the day, I'm waiting to see what pops, and I'll decide then if it's something that I want or not.
Absolutely. And I think a lot of that stereotype of like the starving artist, and we shy away from wanting our kids to like look at music as a potential career in something. But as you said, it is comes in many forms and fashions, and that's another reason why we're doing this whole series, is to open the eyes of our students and parents that are watching too. And this builds up to our fourth question, but it's like you're doing what you're doing not to put bread on the table, but because it means something. So the fourth question the students had was, what benefits have come with being a musician? So this is kind of like your philosophy, your heart and soul. So.
Oh man, I guess I'll start with tactile or like physical things. I've gotten to travel a lot as a result. I've been to Colombia, South America, and all over the United States for this. And I think that, that's one of the best parts. And this is a really old, worn out analogy, let's say, but to say that music is a universal language is not wrong. And you hear it all the time, and they make posters about it and everything, but it's so true. And I play with so many people. My current quartet has someone in it from China. Actually, the other TA of the studio, his name is Shengbo, he's from China. And he brings stuff to the table that I could never bring to the table in our rehearsals because I have not lived his life. And so I think one of the main things you get from being a musician and working in groups and being around other musicians who travel everywhere is just such an incredibly different worldview and such a richer like interaction with people. I have met so many people from so many places, right at my own institution, wherever that was, in Pittsburgh at Carnegie Mellon or here at Miami, and they all bring something different. And so, benefiting, what have I benefited from? I think, well, like I alluded to earlier, the skills I've acquired, diligence and my work ethic and things, just because music demands that, have helped me in everything I've ever done since then. But really, for me, the thing that I think is most important is just all the people I get to meet, all the people I get to work with. It's definitely probably the best part about playing music is working with the other people who are like-minded and want to also, play well and play and have fun and play things that are cool and, all that stuff. It's just a really warm, fuzzy feeling when you finally get to play a concert with your friends, something that you all get to share together. It's very, Very great. One of my all-time favorite things.
And I mean, if we didn't have soul behind what we did, I would question if you're a musician. And I know that everything you just elaborated on speaks to that. So students, as you're listening, I hope that you're encouraged to know that that feeling as a musician can happen as early as middle school when he talks about relationships and who it is we perform with. I still keep in touch with some of my middle school, high school friends that we did band with. And I'm sure you're the same, Mr. Morris, between that and Moorhead. And
absolutely.
But awesome.
Virtually every day. I mean, those are connections that don't break.
Mm-hmm.
Because you guys have done so much together and you understand where each other came from. And I think that that affects how you play together. I think knowing, you know, the best ensembles I've ever been in have been a group of my friends. And I've heard of professional ensembles that don't like each other, that sound great. I just don't think that that works for me. I think I need to be friends with the people that I play with to really understand how they're going to approach the situation. And you know, I think that that helps me, but maybe not for everybody. And that's a whole nother thing. You know, not everybody's the same, so it's totally fine. But
well, and to speak to the relational aspect, you know, I'll put a plug in for a Crosby band program, but you know, our mission statement is about cultivating a musical community, and we have four pillars that we build that on, but it's respect, compassion, responsibility, and service. And like those things, and there's more that I could speak to, but when I think of middle school, like, you know, my heart is that our students, by the time they leave, are not only better musicians, but have come to become better people through that platform of music. So hearing your journey, and clearly that's evident, like, I think that speaks to that. So thank you for sharing that.
Absolutely.
And our last question we have, again, our audience is primarily middle schoolers, but maybe we're getting some high school and parents watching too. But like for the middle school student, what piece of advice would you offer them these years?
Yeah, that's a difficult one, you know, because I feel like everybody says this. Everybody who's older than you says this, but the time is very different right now, especially right now. And so it's a little different. But I, like I said before, I think committing to something is important. Whenever you decide to do band, I think, you know, really committing and practicing and working at what you're doing is, you're never going to be upset that you acquired that ability. And it is a learned ability. A lot of times I think we talk about talent as somebody's innate ability to play their instrument, regardless of how much they've worked. But I think more often natural talent or talent is in the form of how hard can you work or how diligently can you pursue something. And, you know, that might sound confusing, but I think that there are very few things that we as people or as humans cannot do without the appropriate amount of time and like a more methodical approach. And that's how I treat, you know, when I teach now, that's what I think about. I think it's not talent. In the you know, traditional sense, like, are they just good at the instrument out of the box? But it's more, can they work on it? Like, do they possess the ability to focus on it? Can they do these things, you know? And that's maybe more important. So what I would say to you as a middle school musician is to just give it an honest go and practice and listen. I think listen to music. That's something we don't do. And I even catch myself these days, you know, not listening to the music that I'm studying, and then I have a moment where I'm just like, what are you doing? Like, this is what you're here for. Why aren't you doing it? And then, you know, sometimes you need a break, but, you know, listen to things. Listen to lots of types of music. It can be popular, it can be jazz, it can be anything. Listen to lots of types of music, and when I say listen to it, I mean really listen to it. Hear what's going on underneath the lead vocal. Hear what's going on behind the rhythm section, you know. Really pay attention and evaluate it one way or the other, because that's a skill that you will never not need. You will always need to be able to evaluate things critically, and that's a really good way to start, just listening to music you would already be listening to and consuming music, because that's what we're doing here. We're making that. So you might as well get used to consuming it and evaluating it and hearing it in a different level. But
well said. I couldn't have said it better. And I think when we speak to like the middle school musician, when you said times are different, we know why at this point. But you know, if we're lacking the connection, we can still have that discipline at home. And we certainly can go on YouTube and find some of the professionals you recommended and more to just really develop that ear. And what will come with it is a more developed passion for music when we can hear the heart and the soul behind that artist that we do not know, but we feel connected to. So
I used to be upset when I would hear these people, these artists, and I'm like, how I don't sound that good. you hear someone who's just absolutely nailing it and you're like, oh my gosh, I don't sound anything like that. But you know, I've had a change of mindset even fairly recently, and it's like I was saying, it's a growth mindset. How do I get there? I believe that I can do that, or I can get to some level of mastery close to that. It's like, how do I get there? And so don't be discouraged when you hear somebody doing the same thing that you do, but better. Take it as a, not even a challenge, but as an invitation to work on yourself and see if you can get to the same level. And that's kind of a way to make it into a game, or to at least make it into something more interesting than just assigning it to be like, oh, I'm never going to be able to do that. That's really important when you're listening to music. It's like, can you? Yes, absolutely. At some level, you will be able to do that. You just need to work on it.
A big amen to that. And I think the world could learn some lessons through the concepts and truths we've talked to. So, but definitely, I love how you put it about an invitation. And I think middle schoolers, when they're trying to find their stride and their confidence, will sometimes get on that competitive track and not be collegial, not be, we're in this together. Like, that was awesome. Let me work harder, you know? Mm-hmm. So hit the practice room, students, and don't be discouraged by failure, but be motivated. So
Exactly.
And the last point we just segue to is like, we would love to hear you perform something. So you can either send me something that's pre-recorded or perform live. I wasn't sure which one you had in mind, Mr. Morris.
Yeah, I might send you something that's pre-recorded. Unfortunately, last semester I didn't have a recital because school decided to not be a thing. So, but yeah, I can send you something.
Perfect. And what I'll do when I receive it, students, is kind of put like some titles at the bottom that tell us what it is he's playing and where he's playing. So, but Mr. Morris, thank you so much for just making time to do this. I know it's going to mean something to our young musicians and other people that are tuning in to watch this too. But again, big picture, it's me wanting to connect through a camera, through YouTube, to the students that I cannot face-to-face be with, and to hear other voices such as your own, I know is going to make an impact. So thank you again.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Absolutely.
Awesome.
Thoroughly enjoyed it.
Thank you. I'll let you know when this is published.
Absolutely. Awesome.